Title of this message is Near the Edge.
Wow.
If you've ever been to the Grand Canyon, you know how magnificent it is, how majestic it is,
yes,
how mind-blowing it is. I went there to visit some friends, and we went to the southern tip of the Grand Canyon. I had my camera, had two rolls of film. When I got home, I realized that one of the film had got stuck inside the camera. And I said, where are the pictures? I said, just look at these. I'll be real sick, because I took some very good shots. When you go to the Grand Canyon, you see all this, like I said, this majesty. You see these different shades of color, the orange shades, brown shades, all kinds of the cliffs, different shapes and sizes of the rocks. And up above, this big, beautiful blue sky. But the thing that caught my attention was this little plateau just beneath where we were standing. And there was a barricade, not at the end, but keeping people inside the barricades. And out of all that, I zoomed in on that barricade. It was like I saw somebody looking for it. If you want to know anything about me, if there was an open field and there was a library and a basketball court out there, you'll find me in the library. You go where your interest is. That caught my attention because it was out of place. When I asked my friend why that barricade was there, he told me the story. It seems there was a young couple there that had been married. And they were taking pictures. And all of a sudden, this huge gust of wind picked them both up, dropped them. The husband was paralyzed. The wife was killed. And he said, that's why that barricade is there, to keep people from getting too near the edge. Life can be like that sometimes when our circumstances come and just sweep us up and bring us crashing down. In this message today, in the text today, you have a Levite whose duty was to serve in the temple by the name of Asaph. And this problem was a problem that we all have. Here we are, we're telling ourselves, I'm a child of God. Then I should be prospering materially. If we're honest, we admit that.
Yes.
But the whole thing about Psalm 72 is that we're not supposed to envy the wicked.
No.
Mm-hmm. It was particularly hard for the Levite because God told the Israelites that the Levites would have no inheritance in Israel. Why? Because God is their inheritance. But being human as he is, this priest had a double-edged sword. On his one hand, he's concerned for the people, and yet he's troubled by the arrogance of the wicked. So he starts with saying, surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. When he says, surely God is good to Israel, that word good also means keeps covenant faithfulness to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. Does that sound familiar?
Yeah.
Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So this just not, God is not only good to Israel, he only keeps covenant faith with Israel, he keeps faith with those who are upright, who are righteous in his eyes. But his problem said, as for me, surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet came close to stumbling, my steps had almost slipped. I came close to the edge. Edge of what? Walking away. The psalm starts off with affirmation. Surely God is good to Israel. But as I was reading along and preparing the message, I realized he was beginning to doubt. Like we all begin to doubt. Like I begin to doubt God. It's moved from being affirming to questioning. Surely God is good to Israel, right? But as for me, my feet came close to stumbling. My steps had almost slipped. I came near the edge. Why? For I was envious of the arrogant as I saw the prosperity of the wicked. That is not hard to understand in this day and age. That old saying, the rich get rich and the poor get poor?
Yeah.
Well, the poor get poorer. The richer get riches. And they stay there. And I became angry when I saw a comment made by Donald Trump's former wife, who said that the immigrants should work for a living. should work for the wealthy.
Oh.
And the phrase that came to mind was, let them eat cake, and we know what happened to her. I don't know about you, but I'm like David. Lord, I don't want enough. I don't want so much money that I forget about you. I want just enough to live on and relax and not have to worry about anything. But the rich just only intent on being richer. You can get $1 million. I want $1 million. Yes, you will, because once you get that taste, you're going to go on for $10 million. The rich toss and turn, the arrogant toss and turn, the wicked toss and turn, because they're worried about their money. They're worried about what they possess. But here's this Levite says, I was envious. Sometimes people get envy and jealousy mixed up. Jealousy comes from a fear of losing something you already have. Like a spouse being jealous of their partner. Envy comes from wanting what someone else has.
Okay.
And we know from Mark's gospel, envy can lead you to kill.
Mm-hmm.
He makes a point of saying that Pilate realized that the Jews had delivered Jesus up because of envy.
Mm-hmm.
He was too popular with the people. Remember John 8, he says, the whole world is going after him? He said, what about us? What about us? No, they're going after him. Envy can cause you to kill people. Being a priest, he had the task of teaching the people. And can you imagine his frustration? Ministry can be very frustrating sometimes. You don't believe that? Look at Jesus and his relationship with the disciples. Every time he turned around, they were bickering. He had to set them straight, arguing over who's going to be greatest in the kingdom, and Jesus embarrassed, really, no, he didn't set out to embarrass him, but I read it as embarrassing him, teach him a lesson. He very calmly called the child over there, put him on his knee and said, until you become like little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And he told him before, the rulers lorded over each other, trying to be emperor. People be falling down all over each other. And being a school teacher, you see it all the time. You tell the kids, get online, what are they doing? This is my spot. This is my spot. This is my spot. And I said before, look at that. You're acting like grown-ups. Presidential elections aside. So you're acting like grown-ups. Always trying to get a position. You have a long line. This light, and see, even in traffic. You got a long line of cars waiting for the light to change, and people, this person back here in the eighth spot, honking his horn. Where you going? The best part is when you get to the light changes red again. But people falling over each other for position.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. Ministry, that's a Levite. He had to, on one hand, to teach the people, but on the other hand, he was dealing with his own situation. He said, I was envious of the arrogant. And when you're involved in any kind of ministry, and you see how others are doing well, you wonder, Lord, what am I doing wrong? Am I doing what you wanted me to do? Am I serving according to your purpose? Or am I serving to no purpose?
Wow.
If it's to no purpose, sometimes, a lot of times, even if you're not involved in ministry, which you should be, we have to go back and examine ourselves. I'm going to stop saying we and jump on I for a little while, because I had to go back and examine myself. I'm saying, Lord, I had to admit it. I said, Lord, I was envious of my classmates who seemed to be doing well in ministry, and yet I'm constantly struggling. Why is that? Why am I struggling? And Lord very quietly said, you know, comes to the territory. Remember that Good Friday message I gave? About he didn't have to pick up the cross for me. He didn't have to pick up a cross. He knows what he's asking of that person. And the story wrote, you follow me this long, pick up your cross and follow me to glory. You know, just because people are involved in ministry doesn't mean they have it all together. Or they have a clear path. Don't let your circumstances pick you up in such a way to bring you crashing down, to bring you near the edge that you want to quit. So he was troubled about that. And as I said, he's a priest, and he ministered in the temple. Imagine being reminded daily, or as I told someone once before, I'm tired of being reminded about what I don't have. In there, seeing the Ark of the Covenant, right outside the Holy of Holies. Mm-hmm. And when inside the Ark was Aaron's rod, representing God's leadership, the Ten Commandments, which reminded people of his word, mm-hmm. the manna, which reminded people of his provision, and the Ark itself, the Ark of the Covenant itself, which reminded of God's presence among his people. And here he is, tossing and turning on his bed, churning because of what the situation is. He's trying to understand what's going on, let alone being honest, saying, I am envious, Lord. I'm envious. But what happened? He said, surely in vain, got close to the edge. Surely in vain, I have kept my heart pure and washed my hands in innocence. This shouldn't be happening to me, Lord. If you never said that, something wrong with you. You're not human. Surely in vain I have kept my heart pure and washed my hands in innocence. I ain't done nothing. Why is this happening to me? Why can't I do just a little bit, Lord? Why do I have to worry like this every time? Because you're wearing too much. Mm-hmm. You're wearing too much. You're worried about something you shouldn't be worried about. Mm-hmm. For I have been stricken all day long and chastened every morning. You go to sleep, you can't wait to go to sleep because it's on your mind. And you can't wait to get out of that bed because it's on your mind. You can't run, you're stuck. You get near and near to the edge. If I had said, I will speak thus, behold, I would have betrayed the generation of your children. David served his generation. We can only serve this generation. And being a priest, his task was to teach the generation. Not just teach it, but model the behavior. On the one hand, he's ministering in the temple, but even while he's ministering in the temple, he's just saying, whoa, the Ark of the Covenant, God's provision. I'm questioning it. His leadership, I'm questioning it. His provision, I'm questioning it. I'm questioning God's faithfulness. But God is faithful. He knew what was going on in this Levite's mind before the Levite did. He saw it coming. That's why he let him go through it. And how did he go through it? When I pondered to understand this, it was troublesome in my sight. Child nearly drove me crazy, as some of the sisters would say. Until I came into the sanctuary of God, did not perceive their end. We get so close to the edge that we forget about the support we have behind us. We can forget about God's faithfulness in the past, yesterday, today, even though we can't see it, or after we realize it, lay claim to it. And I don't mean like name any claiming. I mean, it's there. It's like this mic is in front of me. It's there. Okay? God's faithfulness is here. And it'll be there tomorrow.
Yeah.
It's like, yes, perhaps, maybe. No. Yes, yes, yes. Because God is always yes. It's not, it wasn't until he went and thought about his situation, thought about himself, that he realized, no, I was wrong, Lord. I was wrong. I'm thinking the opposite of what my position is with you. I allowed the wind of circumstance to pick me up and begin to doubt you. In our everyday living, saints, we do the same thing. The least thing I tell people, I don't care how small it is. You can't find your glasses? Ask God where it is. You can't find that dollar bill? Ask God where it is.
That's right.
Lord, I couldn't find that rent receipt. That... Oh, here it is. Thank you, Lord. Never take the least thing for granted. You're a child of God. If it troubles you, it bothers him. Even though he's not bothered by it. He's waiting for you to ask him. And that's what the priest did. He went to God. He prayed. He talked it through. I said, I'm back to the eye again. What I had to do was, I had to ask myself, Lord, I need to ask myself, whose ministry is it, mine or yours? If it's coming from me, I'm going to be frustrated. I'm going to get angry. I'm going to get upset. I don't want to take it. No. But it's always a time like that. I'm always glad to hear the Lord say, feed my sheep. Bottom line, do what I told you to do. I'll take care of the rest. I'll take care of the rest. I got this. I learned a long time ago, if there was something that I believe God wanted me to do, I didn't need to tear down doors. He would just clear the way. He would clear the way, and I had to beat down doors. That was a hard lesson for me to learn. I had to go lump here, lump here, lump here. He cleared the door. He opened up the path. He'll do it. But first we need to ask ourselves, why am I doing this? Am I doing this because God wants to meet, use me to meet a need? Or am I doing it because I have a need to be needed? That's why a lot of people don't want to be alone by themselves, but you start seeing some ugly sides of yourself. Like I saw, but I said, Lord, thank you. Because after all that talking, I realized I was cool with God. God was cool with me. He always provides. He's always faithful. And it's not a matter of your not having enough faith. I get so sick of hearing that. Did you pray for healing? Yeah. Did you? Were you healed? No. Did you have enough faith? The minute you go to God, you're exercising faith. Amen. If a man with a withered hand could just at the command of Jesus stretch forth his hand and be healed, the minute you go to God to pray, he heals you. That's an act of faith in itself. Mm-hmm. So it's not about you don't have enough faith. God has his plan for each person. Maybe he's delaying because, as I said before, he wants to get the greater glory. He wants to blow the people's mind and your mind too in what he does. At the same time, you may need to develop patience. The wicked don't care. One of the verses says, okay, here it is. The eyes bulge from fatness. Ain't that much eating in the world? You eat so much that you get overweight and your eyes bug out? That's fat. Brother Hunter spoke from the scripture last week about how the wealthy were given out of their surplus. Mm-hmm. Surplus is just saying, I really don't need this. Mm-hmm. You're giving out of the extra. Mm-hmm. I don't need this. But God always provides exactly what you need.
Yes, he does.
Forget about what somebody else has. Don't let the Joneses get you down. Don't allow yourself to come so close to the edge that you forget about God's presence with you. Don't take your eyes off him like Peter did with Jesus. He was all set and ready to walk on the water at Jesus' command. You said, come on. And then all the winds started blowing around him, the water, and then his common sense said, I can't walk on water. Get the edge. Right to the edge. But in his faithfulness, Jesus grabbed him by the hand. And just look at that. Why do you doubt? Why do we doubt, saints? And don't just chalk it up to being human. Why do we doubt? Because I realized, I said, Lord, I didn't realize I could be so fearful. That's the bottom line. We doubt because we're afraid. I'm not saying it to rebuke anybody, it's just a point of fact. Once we examine ourselves to see ourselves as God sees us, as he allows us to see ourselves, as he sees us, it's just being realistic. You're being real. Because if you're not, you're going to fool yourself and go out there and just Next thing you know, boop, over the edge. And may not come back. Don't think it can't happen. It can. You can get so caught up living like somebody else and worried about what somebody else has or what somebody else's ministry is like. And you're just doing this at a friend who's a CPA. He told me how he was kind of let down because he wasn't doing what I was doing. I said, what? CPAs need to hear the gospel too. You are where God has you. I'm not a CPA. I have no head for business. I always hated math. You love it. Crazy. But CPAs need to hear the gospel too. Whatever you're doing, God wants to use you to reach those people. Don't envy the wicked. Don't even think you're better than the wicked either. You could so easily become like them. We could so easily fall into that trap. Why? Because we're over the edge. God won't provide, so I'll do this. And God's leadership? You shall remember all the way you've led yourself? No, you remember all the way the Lord has led you. When we begin to doubt his leadership, it's like taking one step back, one step back, one step back, one step back, until you get so far back, you got a lot of running to catch up with. You need to follow hard after God. That's what we see in that song, I'm Chasing After You. It's not God's not running. God's where he is. But we need to pursue him. We need to run toward him. God's not running. He's standing right there waiting. He said, come on. Come on. Don't quit. Don't get discouraged. Do like the Levite did. Go into your sanctuary. Go to your prayer closet. Get yourself alone with God. And as I'm training, disciplining myself, I sing to him. I know why I sing to him, because a lot of times when I want to talk, the Holy Spirit brings a hymn to mind. He's setting it in order, not me. You start off with praise, you end with praise. You tell him exactly what's going on inside you. And he will let you understand the circumstances of what's going on. Because your circumstance, our circumstances, has nothing to do with our standing with God. Until I came into the sanctuary of God, then I perceived therein. As far as God's faithfulness, look at verse 23. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You have taken hold of my right hand. Sinking, but you pull me up. With your counsel, you will guide me. And afterward, receive me to glory. With your counsel, you will guide me. And you praying, and once we stop yakking, the Lord brings the scripture to mind. If you never had that experience, you don't know what you're missing. Sometimes the Lord will bring it to mind before you open your mouth. You know, but we need his counsel.
Yes, we do.
And he gives it freely. If anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask God. Let him ask without doubt. Why? When you've been to gout, you're getting to doubt. Over the edge. You're getting there. We are all encountering circumstances that are beyond our control. But if we allow ourselves to doubt God in any way, that's taking a step toward the edge. You don't want to fall off. You don't want to fall off. He's there all along, providing, guiding, speaking to us. And if in our hard-headedness, we keep going, I can't go to playing to God because I wind up in the hospital with a broken back, if I live, because I fell away. In fact, you only fall away because you don't want to stay. I say that because every single person in here who names the name of Christ has the Holy Spirit in you. And he will constantly bring people to your mind to pray. To pray. So if you wonder how come you got through and you couldn't get through, the saints were praying. The ones you may know and the ones you may not know. The saints were praying. There is what I'm saying is, in God's eyes, You are legitimate. You too legit to quit. He's not going to let you go. Unless you want to. And if that's a choice, over the edge. Count on God's faithfulness, saints. He's true to his word. It's one thing to read it. It's like it's one thing to see the Grand Canyon in pictures in National Geographic. But it's another thing to go there and see it. It's one thing to talk about God's faithfulness. It's another thing to actually see it. Because your next word will be, okay, Lord, what's next? He's full of surprises. Because he's God. He will never leave us nor forsake us. Whatever we seek to do, he will make the way possible. If I'm frustrated and unhappy with what I'm doing, I question whether or not that's what God has called me to do. Because it's fun serving the Lord. Let's pray. Our God and our Father, we thank you, Lord, that you are the one whose name is faithful. Your first, middle, and last name is faithful, Lord. We just give you the glory because you are faithful and continue to be faithful. But all those, Lord, who are upright in heart, in your eyes, Lord, not in our own. It is you, Lord, who have counted us righteous through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, who himself, Lord, will accomplish the work he desires to do in us, even as you desire to conform us to his image, not he to ours. Lord, in all the tasks that we do, we thank you that you make us realize it is you who suits us to the task, not the task to us. Lord, because you are betrothed, you know what you want to be brought about, you know what you want done, you know how to teach us and at the same time work through us. Lord, we just give you thanks and humbly bow ourselves before you and say, Lord, as the psalmist wrote, whom do we have in heaven besides you? And besides you, we desire no one else. We give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Excellent.